weekends, events. 27th Street has become maybe a place that people didn't want to come today, but so I appreciate you coming out and waving, and my thoughts are with the injured from Saturday evening's explosion on 23rd Street. Tonight's lecture is the first in a four-part series that is funded through a grant from the FIT Diversity Council. So I'd like to first start by thanking the Diversity Council and President Brown for funding the series, and to just tell you to look out for the announcements. We have kind of set dates, but we weren't ready to announce the dates yet. But there'll be another presentation in November, and then two in the spring semester. One of them will be a performance, which I think will be very exciting. So please look out for that. Tonight, our speaker, who I'll introduce in a second, is going to talk to us about an exhibition, Our AIDS America, which is the first exhibition to examine the deep and ongoing influence of the AIDS crisis on American art and culture. It is currently at the Bronx Museum. It's there for about another month, so if you haven't seen it, you've got a chance to still go. It's moving to Chicago after that, and it's opening in Chicago on World AIDS Day on December 1st of this year. There's an accompanying exhibition at the Leslie Lohman Museum of Gay and Lesbian Art downtown. They are partners on this series, by the way. They're partnering with the Leslie Lohman organization to bring you this lecture series. And there's an accompanying exhibition to the Art AIDS America exhibition called The Deeper Dive, and that is open until early October. So if you haven't been to the Leslie Lohman Museum, you should go. It's an amazing institution and resource for the city. And as far as I know, it's the only one of its kind. Please go and support them. And the exhibitions they do are fairly amazing. And they're actually expanding their space, so we're expecting a lot more from them in the future. So tonight, our guest, Jonathan David Katz, is actually the president of the Leslie Lohman Museum. Is that correct? He's an activist, an art historian, an educator, and a writer. He is the director of the doctoral program in visual culture studies at State University of New York at Buffalo. And he is the co-curator of the Art AIDS America exhibition. Please welcome Jonathan David Katz.
Thanks so much. Let's cast our minds back to the very beginning of the plague, all the way back to 1981. Before even gay-related immune deficiency GRID, the first name for AIDS, was publicized, before the political battle lines were drawn and someone like Nancy Reagan here could not only grace the cover of Andy Warhol's so very queer Interview magazine, but offer it an exclusive. She chose Interview for her very first press briefing after moving into the White House. Republicans, of course, at the time, were seen as staid, even boring. And her advisors had suggested that an interview in Interview might make Republican ideology seem a wee bit more hip and with it. By the end of that decade, it was a different world. With the Christian right and rapid ascendancy, AIDS in full lethal mode, and the queer community blamed and targeted as the cause. When, on June 12, 1989, Christina Orcado, director of the Corcoran Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C., canceled their Maplethorpe retrospective called The Perfect Moment a few weeks before it was to open and a few months after the photographer's death from AIDS, she was, in her own words, protecting the institution she directed. I'm showing you here a cover of Art4 magazine chronicling the protests against the Corcoran censorship by projecting images of that banned exhibition on the white marble walls of the Corcoran at night. By this point, the question of federal support for anyone that even tangentially acknowledged either queerness or AIDS had been so brilliantly and repeatedly manipulated into a wedge issue by the Christian right and the Republican-dominated Senate, that censorship was indeed commonplace. Indeed, even today, following years of negotiations with the Corcoran Museum about taking the exhibition Art Aids America, when the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. announced that they were going to take over programming for the Corcoran after the Corcoran's closure, I sensed Art Aids America would be on the chopping block. And indeed, a few days later, the cancellation arrived in the end. The long shadow of the 1980s, that space between interview with Nancy Reagan and the perfect moment, evidently still haunts the American art world. And in this talk, I'm going to try to account for how and why. So let's begin with two quotes from the two of the most defining artists of this period, Jenny Holzer and Felix Gonzalez-Torres. The Holzer's first, and here I'm showing you one of her works. And it is, as you can see here, printed on condoms in a dream you saw a way to survive, and you were full of joy. And Holzer says this: use what is dominant in a culture to change it quickly, end quote. A little more than a decade later, Gonzalez-Torres was quoted as saying, at this point, I do not want to be outside the structure of power. I do not want to be the opposition, he continued, the alternative. Alternative to what? To power? No, I want to have power. It's effective in terms of change. I want to be like a virus that belongs to the institution. All the ideological apparatuses are, in other words, replicating themselves because that's the way culture works. So if I function as a virus, an imposter, an infiltrator, I will always replicate myself together with those institutions, end quote. Both of these key late 20th century artists were prescribing various forms of dissimulation and camouflage as the best mechanism for politicized art in this fraught period of Republican ascendancy. They shared a belief in the power of appropriation, taking something over and using it against itself to smuggle in meanings unrecognized under the very noses of those intent on policing the parameters of acceptable discourse. Holzer and Gonzalez-Torres both had enjoyed significant mainstream success, evidence of their winning strategy of covert social and political dissidence. In a nutshell, artists of the type were faced with a very stark, even brutal choice. They could make a straightforwardly engaged and political art, but the price they paid was exclusion from the mainstream art world, enjoying from participation in the networks of galleries, collectors, and museum collections and exhibitions that is the latter's success in today's art. Or, alternatively, they could camouflage their political intentions and through that circulate in the mainstream art world, thereby reaching a vastly greater audience than the more overtly politicized artists ever could. No wonder so much AIDS art doesn't look like AIDS art. For ever more draconian laws and ever more subtle art world norms work to prohibit any art that addressed either queerness or AIDS, apparently up until the present day, or so it seemed after receiving the umpteenth rejection for Art AIDS America from museums big and small all over America. Indirection and camouflage are most useful in circumstances of real constraint, and the federal constraints on queer and AIDS art in this period have yet to be fully addressed. In October 1987, the Republican Senator from North Carolina, Jesse Helms, successfully pushed through an amendment to a huge AIDS research and education bill that, quote, prohibits the use of any funds provided under this act to the Center of Disease Control from being used to provide AIDS education, information, or prevention materials and activities that promote, encourage, or condone homosexual activities or the intravenous use of illegal drugs, end quote. He thus managed to both fund and cripple the very agency charged with protecting our national health and what was tantamount to calling for a death sentence for the two most at-risk populations at the time. In a chilling barometer of the national mood, Helms's blatantly discriminatory amendment passed by a count of 94 in favor in the Senate and only 2 against. Those 2 were Lowell Weider, Republican of Connecticut, and Daniel Patrick Moynihan, Democrat of New York. This was, in essence, then, a national law against arguing about AIDS, and its effects were immediate and profound. I'm showing you one of them. Donald Moffat's archly funny, but nonetheless quite bitter, by accident, I lick all the wrong holes over and over again. It doesn't mention AIDS, does it? Nor figure the body, nor the virus affects someone, but is nonetheless as surely about AIDS as that logo silencing.